Dear Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for all the things that you have done for us and your grace and mercy upon us. I ask that you bless this time of study, this time in your word here tonight. Help us to know you. Help us to know your scripture. Help us as we go throughout our lives to live in a way that is glorifying to you and to bring your word to bear more and more in our lives, being increasingly obedient to it every single day. And I ask that you bless us all here tonight. Give us wisdom and understanding from the text this evening. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, as we saw this morning, God has given much grace and mercy to the people of Nineveh. He sent Jonah to proclaim the truth to them. The people repent at the preaching of Jonah, and so God does not end up sending destruction upon them. Jonah fearlessly heralded the message. God himself worked mightily, bringing about salvation, and the people repented of their sins for the glory of the Lord. And so what we learn from Jonah chapter 3 is that God is gracious, merciful, and powerful. We see all of that involved here in this particular chapter. We live in a culture that is increasingly pagan, as we all see every single day. Nineveh was a pagan city, and Jonah was called to preach the truth to it. And so we, too, are called to preach the truth in our time as well. And we are called to preach the truth and be increasingly focused on the Lord Jesus Christ himself, which runs in direct contrast to the culture, which is not focused on God, but focused on self and gratifying the desires of self. And so as we continue to read through the repentance of the city of Nineveh, we should be encouraged that God does have the power to save people and to turn around complete nations, which is what we should want not only for this country, but for all the countries, that God would turn them around, bringing great repentance and salvation. And just as Jonah was called to herald the message of God, so are we. And we should go out doing so, knowing that our God is mighty and powerful to save. And so let's read Jonah chapter 3, verses 6 through 10 here tonight. The word reached the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he issued a proclamation and published throughout Nineveh, "By the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and let them call out mightily to God. Let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hands. Who knows, God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger, so that we may not perish." When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he had said he would do to them, and he did not do it. So we see here in verse 6 that the word even reaches the very king himself, who also repents at the message that Jonah has brought to the people of Nineveh. He puts himself in sackcloth and ashes, which of course is indicative of his deep grief over sin. His response is almost identical to the people who we examined this morning, who were grieving over their sin in verse 5 of this chapter. God used the preaching of Jonah not only to change the hearts of the people, but even the hearts of the king himself. And this was truly a city-wide transformation brought about by the power of God. And now in verse 7, we begin to see the start of the proclamation issued by the king to the people of Nineveh. The first part of this proclamation has to do with the people not eating or drinking anything. And also notice how this is issued by not just the king, but the king and the nobles. The involvement of the nobles here shows that the city leaders at large were on board with this. It wasn't just the king himself, but it was all of them collectively issuing this proclamation of repentance that the people would turn from their evil ways. And historically, it was actually a Persian custom to have animals involved in mourning ceremonies. So that would be why you see beasts, herds, and flocks issued here in this particular proclamation. In verse 8, we see where humans and beasts are to be covered with sackcloths, calling out to God. The king is wanting them to repent. He is wanting them to turn to the living God. He wants them to call on God, seeking forgiveness from him for their sins. But now just think about this here for a second, what we see in this passage. This king who is now issuing this proclamation, he was a pagan before Jonah came bringing the message from the Lord. And now he is issuing this proclamation, calling on the people to come to God. And so what do we have going on here? We have a government urging people to serve the living and the true God. And we really can't miss that point as we're thinking about this passage. And it's certainly a worthy application to draw directly from this text. Because the truth is that the government is to be the servant of God. Now, that's what Romans chapter 13, verse 4, explicitly says. It describes the government as God's servant. That word servant being the Greek word from which we get our English word deacon, talking about the position within the church. The government is to be in subjection to God, to bow down before God, and to serve God. The rights that the government is called to protect are given to every single man and woman, every single human, by God the Creator, as our founder said so well. And we see this whole sort of a picture here in the example of the king of Nineveh. This king is actually urging people to bow down before the living God. He is urging them to turn from that which is evil. And what we see here in the book of Jonah by this king of Nineveh is quite a different picture than that painted by many in our society whenever it comes to thinking about government. The culture wants separation of God from government. They don't want separation of church and state. We need to be clear about that. What they want is separation of God from government. Separation of church and state, as we go back and trace that historically, means that the government does not meddle in the church's business. Historically, that is how that has been defined. The attempt to separate God from government, as performed by many in our culture, is ultimately a practice in idolatry. It is to fundamentally deny the purpose of the institution of government and to go against the ordained purpose of government as determined by God himself. Now, to be clear, by making that statement, I'm not saying that the government should force every single citizen to become a Christian. That would not be biblical for a government to take that action. But I am saying that the government and those who hold positions of authority should submit to God, and they should submit to the standard of God, which is His holy word. And they should use their positions to essentially promote the glory of God and urge people to come to the Lord Jesus Christ and to serve Christ. And we see the king of Nineveh taking that specific action here in the book of Jonah, after Jonah has preached his message. Now he specifically tells the people to turn from their evil ways here at the end of verse 8. Now think about that part for just a second. The people of Nineveh, they had served false gods before Jonah came and arrived proclaiming the truth of God himself. The Ninevites, they also did that which is evil in the sight of God, as evidenced by the fact that God himself was about to wipe them out. And ultimately, their standards for right and wrong behavior were completely off prior to Jonah coming and urging them to repent. This nation literally goes from doing so much evil that God is getting ready to overthrow them, to now the king issuing a proclamation urging the people to serve the living God. That's a type of a contrast that we see here in this text. So the king here, he's not just saying that they need to serve God in a general way. Now, what is he doing? He's going so far as to say that they actually need to live in obedience to God and shun that which is evil. They have received the message of God through the prophet, and so they know what they are called to do before God. The only way that a government is going to be able to protect rights by opposing evil is ultimately to submit itself to God. Now, you might disagree with me at that on that point at face value, but I think that it is a straightforward statement if we begin to think about it for a second. For example, did the Roman Empire always do that which is good and urge the people to go against evil, to not do evil? Well, no, the Roman Empire did not always do that. Actually, they lit Christians as torches at one point, so they certainly promoted much evil during their reign. And we know in modern times that our government is not always doing good, and it is definitely not urging people to shun evil. Instead, it is encouraging people towards evil. At least many in governmental positions are. The only governments that ever truly make the choice to fight against true evil are the ones that seek to serve God. If kings and queens and rulers of all kinds are to encourage their people to do good and to avoid evil, then they must bow before God, because He is the one who tells us what is good and what is evil. He is our authority and He is our standard. So the king doesn't just say that he submits to God here. He actually is seeking to live by God's standard and do that as he goes about his business as a ruler and as a king. And we see all of this here in Jonah. And it is a beautiful example of an entire nation bowing before God and seeking to serve him. And it might be better to say an entire city, because it wasn't a nation. But nonetheless, it is a beautiful example of that fact. And this is the type of thing that we should seek to see in our own country, and that we want nations around the globe to be doing as well. We want to see entire nations and entire countries bowing before King Jesus in repentance and seeking to honor him in every single aspect of life. And notice what the king says in verse 9. Who knows, God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger, so that we may not perish. And so the king recognizes a few things here in this verse. First of all, he asserts the fact that God is judge with this particular statement. He recognizes that himself and Nineveh as a whole, they are rightly sentenced to judgment from God because of their sin. They have done evil before God, and they deserve his anger to be poured out against them. And secondly, the king is throwing himself at the mercy of God. And he is urging the people to do the very same thing here in this passage. He recognizes God's judgment, God's holy judgment, and he understands that he needs God's mercy. He is submitting himself completely to God here in this passage. The king does not urge the people of Nineveh to go to try and appease the anger of God on their own. No, he understands that they will only be saved from the wrath of God if they are given mercy by God himself. And what a beautiful picture of salvation this is here in this passage. Who are we saved by? We are saved by God. Who are we saved from? We are saved from God in a certain sense. Why are we saved? Because of the mercy and the grace of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. We're not ultimately saved from the devil or anything like that. We are saved from God's wrath being poured out upon us because of our sins. And we are saved from our sin itself. And that is exactly what the king is recognizing here in this passage. It is the anger of God that would destroy the city. And they are crying out to him that he may relent and not pour out his fierce wrath upon them. And now look at verse 10 here. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he had said he would do to them, and he did not do it. Now here's where we have to pause for a second and take a look at this particular passage of Scripture deeply. The reason that we need to do so is that many in our day and time try to use this verse to say that God actually does not know the future. That sort of thing is rising in popularity, and so we need to address it. Biblical, historical Christianity has always asserted that God not only knows all things, but ultimately is supreme and in control of all things. If you read the Old and the New Testament, you'll see that all over the place. If you go back and you read the great theologians of the history of the church, you will see where they unanimously assert those truths. And if you go back and you read the great confessional statements throughout the Christian church, you will see yet again they unanimously support that as well. But today there is a new heretical viewpoint on the horizon known as open theism. What does this viewpoint assert? It asserts that God does not know the future and that God does not control the future. Those who hold to this view, typically, if not always, will believe that God knows all of the possibilities of the future, but he doesn't actually know the future. What does that mean? When we talk about God knowing the future, take this for an example. We as Orthodox Bible-believing Baptists would say that whenever I step down from this stage, God actually already knows right now which way I'm going to go. He knows if I'm going to step off the stage to the right or to the left, or if I'm going to jump over the front or whatever else. He knows how I'm going to come down from the stage. But an open theist, in contrast, would say that God knows I can go right. He knows I can go left or I can jump over to stage. So do you see the difference? One of them, historic Christianity, says God knows which specific route I'm going to take. He knows I'm going to go right. Open theism says, I know which way you can go. I know all of these possibilities. One of the main proponents of this idea, known as open theism, will actually admit that there are events that can occur which could surprise God or even perhaps disappoint God. And so we have quite a bit of contrast between these two viewpoints here. And we haven't even began to discuss the depths of these viewpoints when it comes to God's control of the future itself. And now I'm telling you about this because it's helpful to have that information so that you're ready to defend the biblical viewpoint. And when you or your kids or your grandkids come across it, that way you'll at least have heard something about it over the past. So how does this tie in with Jonah chapter 3, this particular view? Well, I've actually debated these folks before and had them try to use Jonah 3 to promote their viewpoint. Here's one prominent open theist on Jonah chapter 3. He says, God changed his mind, referencing Jonah chapter 3, verse 10, about the destruction he planned to carry out on Nineveh. If all events in history are eternally settled and known by God as such, his word to Jonah that he planned to destroy Nineveh in 40 days was insincere, as was his inspired testimony that he in fact changed his mind about his planned judgment. So there you go, an open theist will assert that God changes his mind based on this passage. And they will say that he obviously does not know the specific outcomes of the future, nor does he control the future in the sense that we as Orthodox Christians would believe. So what are we to make of this argument? Well, first of all, God clearly does not change his mind. You may remember this from our study through the book of James, but James chapter 1, verse 17 says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. I'm not for sure how much clearer the scripture could be on this issue. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6 also says this, for I, the Lord, do not change. That is the straightforward, explicit teaching of the Word of God. To say that God changes his mind is to contradict the clear testimony of Scripture. And not only that, but in Isaiah chapter 46, verse 10, God is talking and he says that he has declared the end from the beginning. So God not only knows the future, he has already declared the future. Hence why the book of Revelation can be written. We know where history is heading. We know where history is heading because God himself is in control of it. And so needless to say, if we are to accept this idea of open theism, we would be in clear violation of the teaching of the Word of God. And so we must ask ourselves an important question here. What is this passage in Jonah chapter 3 when it mentions God relenting or repenting of the disaster, depending on the version you're using? What does that actually mean? Well, first of all, remember specifically in chapter 3, we saw where God tells Jonah to proclaim his message. In other words, Jonah's not to invent his own idea, he's to proclaim the message of God. So when we read of God turning from his anger, we have to remember what we read in Jonah chapter 3, verse 4, where Jonah goes out and proclaims that the city of Nineveh would be overthrown in 40 days. That is what is referenced whenever it is mentioning turning from his anger, that the judgment of destruction would not be poured out. That's what we see later in Jonah chapter 3. And it's interesting because 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 29, it uses the same Hebrew word here. That text says this, "And also the glory of Israel will not lie or have regret, for he is not a man that he should have regret." That word for regret here in this passage is the same Hebrew word for repent or relent in Jonah chapter 3, verse 10. So whenever we read of God repenting or relenting or regretting, based on 1 Samuel chapter 15, we know that does not mean that he is repenting like a human being does. The text very clearly says that God does not repent like a man. So what does it mean whenever we come to Jonah 3 and we read about God repenting of this evil that he had said he did do? Well, I think what is going on here is a very similar concept to what we see whenever we are actually saved. Well, what's happening? God threatened judgment upon Nineveh, and God sent Jonah to declare the truth to Nineveh out of his own compassion. And by the way, don't miss that point. Jonah didn't just concoct the idea to go to Nineveh because he was so eager. Remember, Jonah ran from this task given to him by God. God is the one who sent Jonah. Jonah chapter 4, verse 11, God says, "And should not I pity Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle?" And so God actually sent Jonah to Nineveh out of mercy that they might repent at the preaching of the truth. But Jonah comes and threatens judgment, and the people repent, and God does not bring judgment. And I want to contend, isn't that identical to what happens when we are saved? Let's say that I walk up to a lost person, and I share the gospel with them. In my gospel presentation, I tell that lost person that they are heading for hell. They are on their way to hell. Now, is that a true statement? Yes, it is a true statement for me to tell a lost person, you are headed to hell right now. If they do not know Christ savingly, that is where they will go. However, if they repent and if they place faith in Christ, then they will not go to hell, but they will be saved. So speaking from a human viewpoint being the emphasis there, we can say that God turns from his anger whenever we are covered in Christ. That does not mean that he changed his mind like we as humans do. But speaking as humans, it is the best language that we can use to describe an infinite God. Here's the point. Let's boil this all down in a nutshell. Just because God sends a prophet to proclaim a message of judgment does not mean that he changed his mind because the people repented and believed in the message. Who do we think actually changed these people's hearts to believe in God? God did. God is the one who drew them to himself. Who do we think actually sent the prophet that they may hear the message in the first place? God is the one who sent the prophet. And so God did it all. But what do we see by those who hold to open theism? They have the audacity to look at God and to say that he is not in control and that he does not know the future. And that idea runs clearly contrary to the entire teaching of the Word of God. What we see here in this passage is the mighty power of God to salvation. I'm not for sure how you could read through the book of Jonah and miss the power of God all over the place. The power of God that sends an entire storm upon a ship. The power of God that preserves a man's life by having him be eaten by a fish specifically appointed for that purpose. The power of God that saves the sailors on the ship. The power of God that saves the people in Nineveh. The power of God is all over this particular book in the scripture. We see a God who is gracious, who is powerful, who is merciful, who has a holy and righteous judgment, and who is so sovereign that he draws an entire nation to himself. There is nothing puny about this God in the book of Jonah or in the Bible at all. And there is nothing that he is not in control of, as we see in this text. He is gracious, and in his mercy he spares Nineveh, and he uses the prophet Jonah to proclaim the truth. And that should be a great assurance to us today, because just like the Ninevites, as we said earlier, we live in the midst of a society being increasingly pagan. But God is still mighty to save, and through the bold declaration of his word, he can bring about a mighty work of repentance, drawing an entire nation to himself for the praise and for the glory of his own name. Let's close in a word of prayer here tonight. Father, thank you for the opportunity to dive into this passage of Scripture. I ask that you will help us to go out boldly proclaiming your truth. We thank you for the fact that even in the midst of uncertain times and differing scenarios of our life, we know that you are in control of all things as the God who reigns above everyone and who is supreme. We thank you for your grace and your mercy to us, bestowing such a great salvation upon us and using us in your service for your glory. I ask that you help us to live faithfully for you this week. And it is in your name I pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.